Welcome to the DTFC podcast. I am Josh, host of the DTFC podcast. I'm recording today with Dan.
You sound just as surprised as you did last time.
I'm shocked that I'm allowed to declare myself host of the podcast.
It's DTFC podcast. I'm Josh.
I feel like if I forcibly just declare myself host, eventually the audience will just buy into it.
Well, not if you question it.
Am I the host? Dan, opening question for today. We got some feedback from our audience last time on the quality and the echo in our audio, and it was recommended that to kind of cut down on that, we do the recording in a closet. But I feel like metaphorically, the DTFC podcast has kind of always been in the closet. What's your take on that, and what are we kind of keeping from the people?
Well, I think today's topic of politics is going to help us come out of that closet pretty quickly.
And I don't know if they're ready for that.
I wasn't ready for that question.
That's okay. We're coming off a really, what I thought was a productive episode last week with Sarah Gray on recruitment and on skills that people can kind of develop to get better at looking for jobs, on steps that companies should take to invest in their workforce. I haven't actually had a chance to listen to that in full yet. I know you spent more time with it than me. Do you have any kind of follow-ups or things that you want to say about that other than...
I thought we had a really productive discussion.
Yeah.
Sarah was great and really articulate with her thoughts. I think that's something that we should probably aspire towards, to be able to...
I thought that set a great example, and she was a fantastic guest. So yeah. Shout out to her. Hopefully she'll feel welcome enough to come back and join us in the closet or out the closet, wherever we are.
Yeah. I need to get a bigger closet.
Bigger closet. Yeah. But so today's topic is going to be a little bit different. We did an episode a little while ago on critical thinking, and there is a federal election coming up in Canada for any listeners beyond national borders. Not sure if there are. But we actually saw this as an opportunity to kind of display some of those critical thinking skills in action to help people maybe make a decision in a way that might be different from how they typically think about political decisions. So my interpretation of the topic today was applying critical thinking to the federal election of Canada in 2021. I'm not sure if you interpreted it the same way, but I think we both have similar approaches to kind of digging into this.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I don't think there's any other way to say it.
Okay.
Dig in from a critical thinking perspective, right?
Yeah, and I think the first step of that, you know, we're not really going to beat around the bush too much today. The first step of that, I think, is asking a few questions that I doubt they will make anyone uncomfortable now that I'm kind of saying this qualifier. But I will say that I think part of being a good critical thinker is being able to ask more questions than the average person generally would, to get to the bottom of what you're doing and to figure out kind of the purpose of the exercise and what your expectations are in regards to what you're going to get out of it. So we're going to do that today. And the last thing I want to say is that I'm not a political expert.
Neither am I.
You may not be a political expert. Yeah.
Not yet.
So we're not here to tell you who to vote for. We're not here to strengthen a particular party's platform. I think actually most of our conversation will be disconnected from any party specific platform and just more about, you know, if you're approaching an election at any place, well, any place with this similar, you know, voting system or government structure, how you might approach just thinking about it and what questions you might want to ask and have answers to before you feel confident in your answer.
Yeah, I think a lot of it has to do with philosophy, strategy, and I mean, at least for me personally, just conversations that I wish happened more often.
Yeah. Oh, 100% agree.
To politics, because yeah, I think, well, we're going to get into it, but
yeah, we're going to talk about why this is such a hard conversation to have. I think I was kind of surprised that you wanted to do this topic, because I know that you typically, like, I will throw out the theoretical topic and then you'll be like, okay, what's the business application? And so I'm curious to know what your business application of this is. I do think there's a question of, you know, whether government should be run like a business or how much it should be run like a business, how much interaction it should have with the business and economic life of the country. Maybe that's something that'll come up. So, you know, we've had a bit of discussion about it, but I think our respective positions might even be surprises to each other.
Yeah.
So here we go.
Sounds good.
Okay. Where do you want to start?
I think we're starting on your list, right?
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, we are following kind of a flow today. So I think the first thing I wanted to do was tie the thought process for who to vote for or how to go about making decisions about voting to our critical thinking episode a few episodes back. And something that we sort of set up towards the end of that episode, if anyone listened to it, was a list of kind of steps that you could take to set yourself up to answer a question in a good way, to come to an outcome that was either accurate or that corresponded well to reality, or that just brought in all the information that was sort of available to you to create a response to a problem that you could be satisfied with. And I think that my personal opinion is that applies to basically every problem that you could encounter. And this is just another one of those problems. But one of the first steps in that process was to identify what sort of problem you were dealing with. And I think this is a really good exercise today because political problems are a particular category of their own, I think, because they fall into a category of what I would call normative problems, which means you're bringing values to bear on a set of facts to make a decision about something. You're not necessarily trying to be a good person or a bad person. You're just trying to accomplish something based on what you think is important. And I don't come to this conversation with any expectation that after I'm done talking to someone about it, we're going to be on the same page, because I try to recognize that people are going to come at this from very different directions. That doesn't mean that I think they should solve the problem differently. I just think that you could give two people the same set of facts about a platform or you know, a country's statistics, and they would come away thinking that the actions you should take based on those facts are very different.
Based on their own experiences, right?
Based on their own experiences. You know, I don't, it's hard to say where their particular values come from, but I think experiences generally, yeah.
Yeah.
What they've kind of been brought up to believe is important, and then just what affects them in their own individual lives.
Yeah. Well, even like life stage too, right?
Absolutely, life stage, yeah. And, you know, there's, you know, conflicts between the interests of different age groups that are typically a big topic for these kinds of elections. So it, even just voting participation tends to vary quite a bit by age group, because the older you are, the more, you know, and I think you've already made your kind of investment in the system, and now you have very high expectations for what you want to see out of it.
Right.
Whereas when you're younger, you maybe haven't made that investment yet. So, and you know, not going to spend a lot of time defending our positions on this. We've already said we're not experts, but I do want to maintain that we're going to say a bunch of things today and you might come at this from a completely different angle. So I think that's something that the audience should kind of brace itself for.
Big time bracing.
Big time bracing, please. Yeah. Everyone brace themselves in the closet. This is already got a ton of potential.
The listeners have to listen in the closet. Maybe that'll help the audio experience.
Maybe. Yeah. Who knows? Yeah, really, the smaller a space you listen to this in, the better it will sound.
Yeah, it's not us, it's them.
The closer we will feel to you.
Right. All right.
Yeah, so I don't know. Do you want to follow, like, where you sent me kind of a list of your thoughts on the topic initially. My view was that your approach was similar to mine in the sense of asking the questions, but I think the questions that were interesting to you were maybe different than the ones that were interesting to me. So do you want to kind of flesh out what your starting point was?
Yeah, so when I was trying to put together an analysis or even a breakdown of where to start or what we should talk about, my natural inclination got me to just thinking about the system as a whole, right? Which incorporates the fact that we're living in a democratic system, right? And obviously there are other systems, communists, socialists, dictatorships, and each of those things have their own properties or qualities. And I think that's something that we're probably going to skip past pretty quickly, but I think that's also something that's a reasonable point to discuss, maybe not on this specific episode, but what, like, a lot of the questions, especially from a critical thinking perspective that I get to, is like, why are we doing this, right?
Yeah.
Or why is it this way? Because if we get the first base assumption wrong, then every other subsequent question or fact or position that we're taking is now like a proxy. No, maybe not. I don't know.
No, yeah, you're building on like a foundation of sand, basically.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. Exactly, right?
Yeah, and I was a little surprised to see your starting point there, because I think, you know, we're kind of participating in an election where certain parameters have already been established. So there's no, like, it's kind of ironically, there's no anti-democratic vote. But
maybe there should be.
I don't think it's a crazy question to ask. And I'll be forthcoming and just say that there's been plenty of times in the past where I have just felt so uninformed about the issues and kind of not interested in the personalities of the people running for office that I just decided not to vote. My opinion in the further past, and we can talk about this a little more, was that if anything, my vote will make things worse because I don't know what I'm doing. And if I was trying to conduct some kind of project of my own, I would probably not elicit the opinions of a whole bunch of people who didn't know what they were doing. Or I certainly wouldn't expect that to make the project go any better. So I do think it's a fair point to talk about, like, should I vote or not? If there's anyone on the fence about doing it in the first place or who finds it inconvenient, is there anything we want to say to them about why you should or shouldn't?
Well, so I was just going to say, because I think it's funny that you brought that up right away, because that's been a thought of mine before. And I've also not voted for the exact same reason in the past. And I've gotten a ton of flack for it because it's stigmatic or whatever. But the point is that people are very against you not voting. And I mean, I don't want to bring up our doctor example from like the critical thinking point, but
yeah.
Like, I don't want to trust your medical opinion if you didn't study medicine for 10 years or however long it is.
Yeah. Yeah. Right? So what is it about the operation of government that makes participation of people in decision making kind of essential as opposed to any other area of specialty that you might encounter in your life?
Right. Which I also think seems contradictory at a certain point, because we're asking people to vote for a person to then represent us, who's then going to just do whatever they want on our behalf.
Yeah.
But our behalf didn't actually make any sense.
He's air quoting.
We don't know anything about it.
Yeah, right.
So like, they're just going to do what they're supposed to be doing anyway. So what are we actually doing here? Is this some kind of like illusion of us making us feel like we're part of this when we really aren't, or maybe we shouldn't be? I don't know.
Yeah, and I think one of the, to kind of maybe approach answering the question, I think you just sort of did. And I think one of the reasons that people have maybe been raised or kind of developed this belief that voting is important is, number one, because there are plenty of places in the world where the citizens of a country wish that they had some sort of participation in the decisions that were being made for them, or decisions that affect them quite a bit. So it is something I think you have to be very careful about taking for granted. And number two, and we can discuss whether this works or not, or whether it's kind of an illusory mechanism, I think it's your way of saying, you know, I cast my vote, therefore the results of a government that I've helped choose are ones that I'm going to kind of consent to. So, and behaviorally, I don't really think people do this. I think they often will vote for a party and then complain endlessly about that party. And, you know, blame a bunch of external factors. But actually, I think, you know, that's not far off from how the proper exercise of politics should be. Like, my vote, you know, when I have taken it seriously and voted with as much information as I could take in, has always been reluctant. It's always been, okay, I personally have a set of things that I'm concerned with. Who lines up best with those concerns? And it's never anyone. So it's always kind of like, well, who will do kind of the least bad job of doing what I think would be important? But again, also not an expert on what's important.
Yeah. Well, and I think this is kind of the point of me starting the entire analysis from the very root of the system, is that everything is based on assumptions, which I kind of already mentioned, which we're assuming a certain thing. So when people say you need to vote, the assumption is you will educate yourself first and then you will go vote. But is that what actually happens in practice? And I think that's where there's theory and then there's actual practicality of the situation. It's like, how many people are actually going through, and like what we're going to do, go through a deep analysis, even ours is not going to have too many stats or actual quote unquote facts, but we're still going through the process and discussing it.
Yep.
To a level. And that's, we're probably just going to do that for like one or two points. Right. So how many people are going to go through that exercise to educate themselves and then go vote? Or is the more likely scenario that their parent or their family or their close-knit group is voting for a certain party, or their job has indicated, okay, as a teacher, you should vote liberal because they're going to support teachers, or vice versa for business people and conservatives or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that the more likely scenario? So sure, in theory, we should all vote and we should be educated before we go vote. But is that actually happening? I'm willing to bet it's not.
Yeah, and it's funny that you mentioned, you know, what we're going to be doing, which I don't know if it quite amounts to a deep dive on many of the issues, but I woke up today feeling like I had missed a chance to study for a test and that it was too late. And I was, the best thing I could do at this point was just kind of wing it. And I feel like that for every election. And then as soon as the actual process is over, I don't go back to thinking about it until I kind of recapitulate that for the next election. So maybe this will kind of hold us to account to actually look at some of the issues in more depth. But I think the points that you made are probably the number one thing that we both are against, which is this sort of team fandom aspect of voting, where, you know, like, I describe myself to people as a Leafs fan in terms of hockey. I get made fun of course, but I recognize that the participation in being a Leafs fan is about, you know, doing something with my family and doing something with a local city that if we did happen to win, you know, for a Leafs fan, that probably won't happen, but the Raptors won.
Wait, what?
But it's a collective experience where the experience, the value of the experience itself outweighs the result, right? Like, it sucks that the Leafs lose and it gets me down, but experiencing that loss with a bunch of people that are close to me is hilarious. And
community building.
Yeah, it absolutely is community building.
Yeah.
But I don't think voting is like that. I don't see voting that way. If the Leafs continued to lose every year for the next 10 years, I would still be a Leaf fan. If a political party that I started out supporting no longer was passing policy consistent with my political values, I would stop voting for them. And I think that that difference puts a responsibility on me to stay vigilant about monitoring what they're doing and just not constantly identifying with the same party every election, because those things do shift quite a bit over time. So probably similar to you, when I encounter someone who's just like, oh, you know, I've always voted this way, my parents have always voted this way, I can't really see myself voting for anyone else, I personally don't find that a valid approach to this problem. I mean, I'm not going to say it's invalid, but I find that sort of, I'd be uncomfortable starting from that position.
I'll say it's invalid.
Okay.
We said we're going to be controversial. I don't even think we said controversial, but it's going to be.
Yeah, okay.
Sorry, no one listens to this podcast anyway.
I didn't consent to this.
Sorry, we'll put the disclaimer in the bottom of the video. You will be offended.
You may be offended, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not going to rule it out.
All right, so we were talking.
How do you react to this team thing? Because I think we want to talk about why this conversation is so hard to have. And for me, that's the number one reason. And it's only gotten stronger since I've become sort of politically aware. And we can talk about reasons for that, social media and whatnot. But I don't know, what's your experience trying to have these conversations?
So funny enough, we just had a politics lesson the other day from some well-known, or not well-known, but they were, yeah, well-informed, we'll call it.
Okay.
Yeah.
That sounds good.
Yeah. So, I mean, it was actually very well-timed. So I definitely learned a bunch, but it was, we didn't get into the specifics of each party, right?
Okay.
It's more about like how the system works and all that kind of stuff, which is good general information. But I find if you're already decided what team you're on, it's like, okay, Leafs fan versus Habs fan, right?
Yeah.
Can we have that discussion between two different fans from two different teams of which team's better? Some people you can.
Yeah.
And even that is like arguably not valuable or relevant, or no one's going to die if.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Maybe not.
Different level of urgency.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And even then you still can't have the conversation sometimes with some fans, because that's it. That they're,
yeah.
Like, were we allowed to talk shit when the Canadians made the finals? Like, not until they were losing. Right?
I feel like you're calling out Nico here.
Yeah.
That's okay.
There's,
okay.
And a lot more people since he actually got to the finals. Find out about after. Like, oh, okay. It's like all the Raptors fans. Like,
yeah.
Talk a bunch of smack about them too.
Right. Always an element of, what's it called? Bandwagoning.
Bandwagoning. Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I guess to answer the question, I don't think this conversation happens too often, which I think is fundamentally not the way the system was designed for it to work, right?
Yeah, and I know personally, like, I always feel like I'm caught in the middle where there's either someone who's like really passionate but not really showing obvious signs that they've looked deep into issues, telling me that I should also be passionate or, you know, in favor of a particular party, which I don't really like, or I'm talking to someone who actually answers these questions as honestly as they can, for maybe because they work in government or because they have some deep investment in some issue. And then I feel like, oh my God, I'm so not qualified to assess anything compared to this person. So I do find that's a kind of an uncomfortable zone, but I also, you know, feel better because I feel like there's a lot of people who kind of fall into that and who want to think about this way, but maybe don't have the, you know, community or relationships to maybe do that. Mm-hmm. So now that you're in a relationship with DTFC, we can do that together.
Finally. Yeah, no, I think the thing I was going to say about the passion concept is, I think passion is the exact issue, right? People think that their passion clouds judgment. I think that's like a fundamental point that I have to bring up, is because people assume that, oh, well, I'm really passionate about this thing, I must be correct, right? I mean, I wouldn't be this passionate if I was wrong, right?
Yeah, and I think, you know, we can have another discussion on the merits of certain kinds of activism and then about, like, as a political subject, when will an issue kind of get to the point where you feel obligated to now have a passion to oppose it. Like, I probably feel like there are some things the government could do where I'd be like, you know what, I am moved enough by this being wrong that I would try to do something to prevent it. And whether that's going to a rally or I don't know, I don't really know what the solution is in that sense. But the people that I see in that position currently, and again, not trying to make any kind of blanket statements or like condemnations of anyone, I think typically if passion outstrips information for me, that's a red flag. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if someone is feels really, really strongly and I ask them a few questions, you know, in an effort at honest exchange, like, what are you basing your passion on? And I'm not getting that information back or it's not clear, that's probably not someone I'm going to take a lot of political, you know, advice from.
Right. Yeah, I don't think passion can supersede logic.
Yeah.
And I think that's, so I mean, I was going to tie it back to like trading the markets, right? When you're making an emotional decision, and if you've done this any number of times, generally your emotions will lead you down a dark path,
right? Yeah.
Or lead to losses, which if we could figure out a way to be logical about our decisions or have a plan or a checklist or all these things that we should be doing when we're, let's say, trading or whatever, that usually solves the problem, right? Or at least it leads to better decision-making, right? And I think the passion clouds the judgment, clouds the logic, that people then make the assumption that they're correct about certain things, and that may not be true, right?
Yeah, and I also feel like it improves your ability to communicate where you're coming from. If someone just disagrees with you and they're passionate and you're passionate, there's no real way to overcome that. Right? It's just a standstill. Or it becomes a battle of who's more passionate or who has more power, which I think is a worst case scenario from a political perspective. Mm-hmm. So I do think, again, part of the exercise of politics is bringing up those justifications, bringing that information to bear with the expectation that you're rarely going to be talking to experts, but, you know, in an honest attempt to bring the right criteria to, you know, help you focus on the issue.
Yeah. And I mean, I think the answer can be neither of us know, right?
Yeah.
Or we don't have enough information to make the next logical step.
Right.
Which should be the answer for most of us most of the time. But somehow somebody has to win, or we have to end up at some conclusion where we have the answers, where we probably don't have the answers.
Right.
And I mean, this is another whole topic just about data analysis and manipulation and all that, but do we even have the right data to make any of these judgments? Does anybody have the right data?
Yeah.
I don't know. Right.
Yeah. And I mean, I think we kind of talked about this from a work perspective, but going into situations where the expectation was, how is, you know, what's the best interpretation of a bunch of data to solve this problem that I have? And the main obstacle to that is just getting the data. And I certainly don't think that governments are at the top of the data kind of collection or transparency game. I think that's something that became really obvious during the course of the pandemic, where it was like people had all these questions about what was going on where, and it just took what felt like forever for that information to kind of be routinely displayed in a way that we could all easily access. And still today, like, I don't know why active case count is not the top number for every province. Mm-hmm. Like, daily cases is nice and resolved cases is nice, but I don't want to have to do a calculation every day to figure out how much of something is out there.
Yeah, which I think maybe takes us to another level of data analysis that I think most people are not doing, which is fine.
Yeah.
I think that also then informs the government on what stats to release or what they should be telling us. Like, even interestingly enough, I found that when I was looking at COVID Ontario data, or like the website for the stats,
yeah,
about like maybe a few weeks, and I could be off by a little bit here, but of them releasing the vaccines, they switched over the main data. So like I had it as a bookmarked link to the COVID Ontario data homepage, which before was giving case count. It then very conveniently slipped to vaccination count.
Okay.
You have to click on a different link to get to the case numbers and the spread and all that kind of stuff.
Interesting.
Right? Which they did on their own.
So yeah. They
obviously strategically made the change and then decided that, okay, we need to care about vaccinations now,
yeah,
not the case numbers.
Right.
It's like, okay, sure. That might make sense.
Yeah.
Again, this is all politics.
And I'm glad you put it that way instead of jumping immediately to somebody's trying to hide something from me or, you know, because we make dashboards at work all the time and the information that's relevant to be on the dashboard is not always going to be the same over time. And just because you're removing something from a display and putting something else up, I think it really does mostly reflect a shift in priorities and not some like underhanded attempt to hide certain information. And not that that's impossible either, but I think there's kind of a burden of proof on someone who's saying that there's some ulterior motive there.
Right.
But yeah, very good point, because kind of a sketchy is the wrong word, but kind of a strange thing to happen when there's this big shift in kind of preventative procedure going into play.
Right. And I mean, I might be making a huge assumption here that they did this on purpose, or that maybe they just wired the URLs differently now and it
yeah.
made more sense to change it. And the link that I had now just got pushed to this other site, right? Or this other page on the website, right?
Yeah.
So that's, again, not enough information.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
That's the bottom line.
Right? I find it funny that my main sources for information are kind of interpretations of public data from people on Twitter, for example. And maybe we can talk about how that reflects on the competency of the government when there can be this sort of grassroots movement of people who are, you know, responding to a demand for information to be displayed a certain way that the government is less kind of flexible toward.
So that's what you're using for some of your data now, Twitter?
Yeah, yeah. Like, I just find it's accessible. There's certain people that kind of pull from sources I consider reliable, but display it in a way that captures what I'm interested in.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So, you know, it's a public service.
Yeah.
Thank you to them for doing that.
Agreed.
Okay. So any other thoughts on political disagreement? I think we've kind of put forth our ideas on what these conversations should look like and where people should be coming from. Any thoughts on this being like any worse today than it's been in the past?
Well, I mean, I think we can both agree that it's very polarizing generally.
Yeah.
The conversation as a topic.
Yeah.
But I mean, maybe it just depends on what circles or people you're hanging out with, right?
Yeah.
Maybe we're out of touch talking all these. I mean, COVID has not helped us being able to be social, right?
Yeah, that's absolutely
so
true.
Who knows? Maybe all the young kids are talking about politics and it's a regular thing.
Oh, we have such hope for the young ones.
Someone has to, right?
Yeah, but I do think the reduction of politics to kind of sound bites to social media posts. I think that there was kind of a situation in the States that looked a little bit dangerous for a while, and the urgency of the politics there kind of flood across the border, even though it might not be quite the same situation here, thankfully. That could be right or wrong. I don't know. I read and I hear that today we're kind of more polarized politically than ever. I don't know if I see the results of that on the ground level. I don't know if I've really been engaged with this for long enough to have seen those shifts. I think since Justin Trudeau kind of became a candidate, there has been this swelling of support for him based on sort of social cultural issues that has sort of always been present in my politically conscious lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe I don't remember a more like dispassionate kind of policy based politics, but I am skeptical that ever really existed. I think there's just different tools of communication today, ultimately. And
yeah, I mean, I think I'd have to have a hard time believing that it's better now.
Yeah.
Just the way things are going, like you said, like short soundbite type information,
yeah,
you're not going to be able to get a lot of detail in a very short, concise statement,
right?
If it's even factual at all.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, so let's take that into what information do you want? If you're making your choice of federal candidates in a perfect world where you can access some document or dashboard with a bunch of numbers and figures that will help you make a decision, where is your decision coming from?
Yeah, well, I think this probably ties into your question of like how to vote, right? Which I think there's probably two stances like you were talking about of, okay, should you vote for yourself or should you vote for what is best for the country or for the people, right?
Yeah.
So maybe we should start there, or did you have another direction you wanted?
Yeah, I wanted to talk about first your kind of expectations for the federal government and things that you, based on media around this election that I've seen so far, I find personally quite a bit of disconnect with the issues that are being discussed versus the issues that I find relevant for selecting a federal leader. Personally, there are a few things that I think the government of a country are sort of responsible for. And those basic responsibilities include things like national security or managing the economy and the business cycle or managing inflation and unemployment and international relations, foreign trade. Like there's kind of a list that I think is... I'd like to hear someone kind of present their issues of what their priorities are based on those. Mm-hmm. And I have kind of written out that list in a way that, like, I don't mean to order them by priority for myself personally. Like, I think most governments of most countries have to deal with the same set of issues. And I'm not being kind of narrow-minded by saying, this is what I want my candidates to be talking about. Now, obviously, they only have so much time on the campaign trail to speak to so many people about so many things, so they're selective about which of those responsibilities they're going to broadcast. And my take on that is that what they're broadcasting is not always proportionate in terms of importance to what they're actually going to be working on. Sorry, that was kind of a lot.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it's... I guess the point is more of like, why are we even talking about any topic at all? Like, how did we choose which topic to talk about, right? And I think it's when we start going through this social media type world where things need to be clickbaity, that we start veering off into this marketing sales kind of world, which arguably I would say politics is marketing and sales anyway, right? I think there's a big assumption that we're thinking that people are talking about what needs to be talked about. It's like, well, if the voters care about this, I'm going to talk about this,
right,
which doesn't mean that's the most important issue. That just means that that's what's going to get the vote. So I think we have to fundamentally understand that that's how the system works. So for our expectation to be for them to talk about things that are important, first of all, we have to define what important is, but
yeah,
we also then have to assume that everybody cares about what is quote unquote important, which may not be the case.
Yeah, agreed. Right?
Which, like, I think you're kind of alluding to it, and I found the same thing when I went through the quiz from, like, a Vote Canada CBC or whatever.
Yeah.
Is that there were a lot of questions on there that I was very surprised to see.
Yeah.
And that came up multiple times. And I'm like, wow, this is very interesting that this is what is being talked about right now. And yet when we look at some of these other information sources that are giving us summaries of all the different things that, for example, small businesses might care about, very few of those came up as questions. And maybe the small business community is very small, and maybe that's a minority, and maybe that's not what we need to be talking about. But I would argue that there is at least some percentage of the population that's going to get affected by that, that we should probably ask at least a couple questions related to that, as opposed to some of these other questions. And I won't get into
the
topics, obviously, which I'm sure we can figure out from the closet.
I do want to talk about that document that you just referred to there. But yeah, first, I just want to acknowledge the point that you made where there are certain choices being made about what the conversation is going to be about. And I think this is true in the quizzes. I did quizzes myself where I had the same reaction to you, same reaction as you, where I was kind of asked multiple times about specific topics, and then I was placed on kind of a scale of where my politics sit, where if you had asked different topics, all still related to federal responsibilities, and I'd answered those in a similar way, I would maybe be very different on the spectrum. So your alignment really depends on the context that's being set up for you, and different people might be kind of setting that context in a particular way. And I think we saw this in the debate based on, you know, there being finite time and certain issues being selected by moderators in the audience to ask about. And you might come away thinking, you know, one person had a bunch of really good positions on a bunch of relevant issues that were shown in that debate, but the conclusion that they're therefore a better candidate might rest more on, okay, what do they not talk about? So just another way to kind of expand the scope of what you have to think about before you make this kind of decision. What information do I have, but what information am I missing? Yeah. And your other point about the marketing thing, like it almost reminds me of a company that has a really strong brand because of a particular product, but really makes their money on some other service.
Exactly.
Where it's like, you know, we're going to advertise based on this, but the important function that we have to do to kind of stay in business is actually something completely different.
Right. Which I don't disagree with at all. Like from a business perspective, like I think it's genius, right?
Like, play the system.
Yeah. I mean, that's Google's entire model, right? Like they promote that they're, or maybe it wasn't Google, but I think Google is an example too. I just can't remember what their actual sales come from. Mm. Might be just ads, but,
Amazon is the one that comes to mind to me.
Yeah,
like
maybe it was Amazon.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, exactly. But I mean, if that's your model, I mean, Tesla does the same thing, right? Like they assume, you assume they're a car company, but they're made most of their money from the government subsidies or whatever, right?
Yeah. The assumption that they're a technology company or, right. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is cool. I mean, hey, do what you got to do, right?
Yeah.
But I think we also, as a society or as people voting, you have to understand that that's what's happening. And if you assume, oh, well, this guy spoke really well and that's what I need in a politician, it's like, okay, maybe, but what is he going to actually do?
Yeah.
If we turn around and look later and it's like, oh, well, they didn't actually do anything, but they talked really well. That was important to me.
Right.
It's like, okay, that's cool. If that is what is important to you, that's fine.
Yeah. And to just put in some specific examples, I think I'm cautious to do this because I don't really want to give the impression that we're leaning towards any particular issue. But I think something that was important to a lot of liberal voters when Justin Trudeau was first elected was the abolishment of the first past the post voting system. So I think a lot of people feel like, you know, they have a choice between two majority parties or majority kind of candidates. And if they vote really in alignment with their own preferences, which could be, you know, a third party, they're just kind of throwing their vote away. And the first past the post system kind of guarantees that by requiring sort of a minimum number of ridings to establish a majority government and forcing everybody to kind of vote respective to who that they expect that majority to kind of be composed of. So, you know, the Liberals kind of came into power and made this promise that they were going to get rid of that system. And then they did some kind of study or set up a sort of commission on it. And I don't even know what the results were, but I know that nothing happened. Mm-hmm. So that was kind of a really quick turnaround on a pretty fundamental issue, even in that election cycle. Like, this is not even an issue that was sort of swept under the rug because it was too complicated for people. This was like people were explicit that they were voting Liberal to get rid of the system. And it did not go away.
So, I mean, and I haven't been following too much in the thing, or I guess the news with it right now, but has that come up?
No.
No?
No.
Interesting.
And this is another thing I find difficult with each respective kind of voting cycle, which thankfully in Canada are fairly short. But no one is really doing an assessment of performance. So there are some really cool websites out there. I forgot what this particular one is called, but they tend to be like the leader and then meter. So you have like a Biden meter or a Trump meter. Mm-hmm. And what it'll do is it will document all of the promises that they make on the campaign trail and then set up a very, you know, measurable specific criteria for meeting those promises and give a sort of percentage for how many were met, which I think is a really good way of, number one, holding position like politicians to account for what they promise.
Yeah.
Number two, just documenting how much a particular government has done, because, you know, Trudeau's been prime minister for 6 years. And if someone was like, okay, what are the major accomplishments of that government? I don't even know where I would go to look for that information. Most of what I would say would be based on the news cycle, which is a connection I don't especially like.
Right. Yeah, no, that's a really good idea. I mean, honestly, I've had similar thoughts of, doing something like that. I mean, I just don't have time to put anything like that together, but that seems super useful.
Yeah, and just set up a benchmark.
Yeah.
Even if it's low, like maybe most politicians follow through on 30% of their promises. At least then, if someone follows through on 10, you know, you have a discussion about why they perform so poorly.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's something I'd recommend checking out if that's, you know, assessment of actual performance is interesting to you.
Yeah. Well, but I guess that's part of the game, and I'm sure they all realize that if they start calling each other out for performance issues, then they're all going to get called out, and then they'll have to actually make performance gains.
Well,
it seems like a lot more work than just talking a bunch of shit.
Right. Yeah. And I wonder if there is almost like a collective agreement not to be too specific with their criticisms. I noticed in the debate, like Jagmeet Singh actually did a really good job of calling out Justin Trudeau a few times for slips of the tongue that weren't especially accurate. and it almost seemed like the reaction to him was not, hey, like, you know, I'm not wrong about this, like you're wrong. It was, hey, I was wrong, but why did you call me out for it? Like, it's like you're breaking a taboo or something. Mm. I wonder if someone who actually had a chance of getting in power would be more hesitant about that because they don't want to be called out in the next cycle. But just another thing that clouds our perception of what's going on.
Yeah. Well, so, I mean, along the topic of debate, so I actually, a friend of a friend, someone that I knew worked in the offices of Trudeau, and they were telling us, some stories here and there, nothing, I mean, specific or anything, but even just the concept of they have a script, right? So they're, okay, sure, they might be sounding like they're talking really well, but it's not like they're coming up with things on the spot.
Right.
They literally have like a binder or a folder of full of information of things that they're just flipping through or hopefully have gone through and understand at least a good amount of it to be able to respond to things, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, we call it a debate, but it's basically like Battleship or whatever you want to call it.
And this is another, I think, product of the social media ecosystem. And you saw this, where this stands out to me, like I heard rumors that this was kind of a phenomenon, but I didn't believe it until the Republican primary conventions in the United States in 2016, because there was an episode where one of the candidates said this kind of canned, like minute-long speech that obviously didn't answer the question that was asked whatsoever. And another candidate fully called him out and was like, this guy's literally just saying this so people that like him on YouTube later will watch that 1 minute clip of what he just said with no idea that he didn't answer the question, not realizing that he's like specifically appealing to them, just like taking advantage of the media format, which was number one, a hilarious call out, and even better because they went back to the other guy and he just did it again. So he didn't even try to like take up that fight. He's just like, oh, camera's back on me, like hit the talking points, right?
Yeah.
And that's a special skill itself. I don't think that's a skill that necessarily is correlated with being an effective public servant.
Yeah,
but it's some kind of spectacle to watch from the outside, that's for sure.